and welcome to ET Insight, where we get you a 360-degree view of the big picture in business and economy. I'm Sridhar Ramakrishnan, and here's what we have for you on the show today. In a bid to tame rising inflation, the RBI has raised interest rates once again. But higher rates are hurting growth and will continue to do so for some time to come. So should the central bank have erred on the side of growth? And find out why India needs to tackle inflation on an urgent basis to get out of this vicious cycle. A top story first. The inflation monster refuses to leave India. And now it's apparent that there are no easy ways to control it. So when the RBI increased interest rates for the 12th time in 18 months, many in India Inc. cried foul. After all, it has hurt growth without really cooling food inflation. So the question we're asking on this show is, should the RBI have erred on the side of growth?
It was not long ago when India was a shining star in Asia. A high growth rate fueled by policy reforms and a benign interest rate environment. And its much talked about demographic dividend made it a must-have for fund managers around the world. But not anymore. Growth has slowed down because of high input prices, falling demand and the turmoil in the global market. It's been a long-drawn battle for India Inc., which is already running out of steam. Then came the unkindest cut of all, another hike in interest rates.
I really believe very strongly that RBI should have paused. The first few rate increases are okay, but I think they're coming to the point where they're driving down demand without controlling inflation. And there's a reason for that. Inflation is being set off by high international commodity prices, which are not going to be controlled by controlling demand only in India, because it's a global phenomenon. The second problem with NAREGA and other flagship programs, you're putting money in the hands of people who are buying. So, and your fiscal deficits are rising. So your rising fiscal deficits and your global commodity and food prices, which are going up, is being controlled by a single instrument of monetary policy. I had said many times, and CII has been saying it, that this will only result in lower growth and continuing high inflation, reducing the number of jobs, reducing gross capital formation, and be very bad for the employment in the country, and particularly those who are working for subsistence wages.
And it's showing in the numbers. In August, India saw a fourth successive decline in the HSBC Purchasing Managers Index, a headline index which measures the overall health of the manufacturing sector. HSBC's data revealed that the rate of expansion was the weakest in the current 29-month sequence of growth. That is mainly because of three reasons: weaker new order growth, which led to a slower rise in production, a sharp contraction in new export business, and strong increases in input costs and output prices. Even the controversial industrial production index hit a 23-month low. It's not been an easy decision for the RBI to raise rates, but the central bank would rather err on the side of caution.
This was arguably the hardest decision for the Reserve Bank of India. This was the 12th time that we have seen tightening of the liquidity, and I think this was the hardest one. And the reason is not difficult to see. There were pulls in two very different directions, and both that information came in over the last couple of days. Industrial growth slowed down quite a bit. The last data that we got down to 3.3%. Inflation increased marginally to 9.78%. And when these two go in different directions, it is indeed a big quandary.
Indeed it is. The RBI has stated it was imperative to persist with its anti-inflationary stance because a premature change in stance could harden inflationary expectations and dilute the impact of past policy actions. According to the central bank, the monetary policy operates with a lag, and the cumulative impact of the hike in interest rates should be felt in a further moderation in demand and reversal of inflation towards the later part of 2011 and 12. India Inc. realizes that higher inflation is a bane, but it believes that the RBI could have paused for a breather.
It's important that you create an atmosphere, you create a climate where there is fresh investments that happen in starting of new projects. See, at the end of the day, even if you look at inflation, a lot of the inflation is supply side constraints, and you're not going to remove those supply side constraints by just increasing interest rates. So rather than interest rates, one of the other avenues which to my mind is available with the Reserve Bank is to ease the foreign currency borrowings. Permit companies to borrow money under the external commercial borrowing window with much greater ease. Because if you were to do that, then the arbitrage in the sense that the way interest rates are in the Western world and the way interest rates are in India, you would end up companies borrowing money from overseas, fully hedging their liability, fully hedging it, paying the withholding tax which is required under Indian tax laws, and still end up saving about 200 basis points. And what that would do is it would help the rupee to appreciate. Today, one of the big worries is the rupee is depreciating every day. And if the rupee depreciates, it causes a bigger inflationary problem in future. So if the rupee were to appreciate, that by itself will solve part of the inflationary issues.
There is extreme caution in terms of increasing interest rates anywhere in the world. We could consider looking at a wait and watch attitude.
Experts agree. The RBI has successfully tamed inflation by raising rates on several occasions in the past. In 2001, there was a steady reduction in policy rates motivated by a moderating inflation scenario. This supported investment activity, which was relatively buoyant during this period. In 2005 and 2006, the cycle turned and there were steady increases in policy rates in response to rising inflation. Then, as the impact of the crisis was felt, there was a sharp reversal in all policy instruments when non-food inflation went negative. As the economy recovered, inflation also rose, and the RBI got into action, raising rates once again. While raising rates may not necessarily be the best answer to the current problem, many are of the opinion that India Inc. is crying wolf too early.
I think there are many things that need to be done to revive investment. Clearly, a moderate interest rate environment is a very important part of it. But these are short-term moves. So if inflation is brought under control and the rate hike is reversed in a few months' time, the really important thing on investment are the longer-term constraints on implementation, which we really need to look at.
But easing longer-term constraints is a painstakingly slow process, as has been seen in the recent past. An industry needs respite at the earliest. Particularly the SME sector, which accounts for nearly 45% of India's industrial production and 40% of its exports. Falling export orders, a capital crunch, a 25-30% shortage in labour, and a rise of nearly 5 percentage points in interest rates has hit the sector hard.
SMEs are facing problem, and increasing rate of interest means you cannot change every time your contract with the any corporate, say like it is a contract signed in a March for 1 year, you cannot change it 12 times in a year. And similarly, it is impacting on not only the SMEs, SME sector, but it is suppliers, labor charges going to be increased, the cost of the raw material is going to increase, manufacturing rate will be increasing. So therefore, it will be impact on SMEs growth, and ultimately it will on the impact on the Indian economy.
India's problem is not a unique one, and inflation is a double-edged sword. While it is necessary for growing economies, it can also slow down growth. The trade-off between growth and inflation has been a matter of global interest for a long while, and many studies talk of a threshold rate of inflation. If inflation is below the threshold, workers and producers do not raise their wage and price demands very often because the impact of inflation is not too visible. But the relationship is reversed if inflation is above the threshold, and higher rates of inflation are accompanied by slower growth. Inflation above the threshold erodes the living standards and profitability of workers and producers and makes them respond quickly. So what is India's threshold level of inflation? The report on currency and finance, an annual research publication of the RBI, examined this in 2000 and 2001 and said that 5% was the growth maximizing rate of inflation for the Indian economy. Currently, India is far, far away from that, and that's why it's worrisome for the RBI. That explains why the Prime Minister too has been emphasizing on controlling inflation for several months now.
Whatever be the cause, the fact remains that inflation is something which needs to be tackled with great urgency.
Indeed, lest the problem spiral out of control.
The increase of 300 basis points in interest rates has not impacted inflation. Now you have to go behind the question. Why? Because inflation, there are three main factors for inflation. Two are entirely beyond our control: crude and commodity prices.
That's right.
We import both these items. And the third item is food inflation. Food inflation we can control.
Food inflation is at near double-digit levels despite normal monsoons, indicating that inflation has been driven by structural demand-supply imbalances.
Inflation and what you see in terms of industrial growth in industrial production not necessarily go in tandem. I think we have an inflation that is largely driven by supply-side constraints, and the supply-side constraints are getting even worse with the situation in the mining sector right now. So there's a little bit of disconnect there.
Add to that the fact that the government's fiscal imbalances have widened between April and July this year. According to the RBI, revenue receipts have declined and non-planned revenue expenditure has risen on account of higher petroleum and fertilizer subsidies. In the first 4 months, the fiscal deficit was at 55.4% of the budget estimates and significantly higher than the 42.5% in the corresponding period last year.
To be fair, the RBI is doing all it can to control inflation through monetary policy tools. And if past experience is anything to go by, then hiking interest rates is the right way to steer the economy out of this vicious cycle.
So why is inflation proving to be so stubborn? And what can be done to bring it down? We get you that story after this short break. Stay with us.